that wouldn't damage the opponent's tower. It only served the purpose to constantly distract the enemy mortar. Now, here's the thing. This kind of tournament setting, a lot of these guys are not very familiar with. So these things about understanding an opponent, going, I know that my opponent is going to use a mortar deck. So do I go straight in with constantly going for distracting units, or does he try what worked for him in the original game and no counter pick is necessary?
Now, last time we saw Nazim play earlier today, it was a lot of counterplay. That's what we saw the most. It was just an incredible amount of just waiting for his opponent to make a move, and then he had counters ready. He's already going in for this goblin hut. And we see the mortar go straight down from Steroidy, but I think it is
misses completely. Wow. Because of the speed on those goblins. Fantastic play. I love the idea that he's actually gone for the goblin hunt instead, just to outspeed that mortar. And immediately, you can tell that Nazim has done his homework.
Yeah, Nazim is 100% ready for this mortar. He has the building, the cheaper building in the goblin hut to distract the mortar from shooting his towers. And he's got the lightning ready as well to deal serious damage to the mortar. I don't think the mortar's going to do much at all in this game.
Okay, so, and just like that, he has the lightning ready to go. So he waits for the goblin barrel to appear and then go straight in. Fantastic play right there as well.
You see the skeletons are going to split off. Skeletons not too much of a threat by themselves. They do die in one hit to the towers, but again, Nazim's got this defense going up again against this mortar. We see the Tesla tower and an Inferno tower. So many buildings coming out from Steroidy right now.
That's a lot of vortification right there, I mean, and it's just going to act as one giant distraction. The question is the bomb going to reach the target? Ooh, just like that, wow. Taking out the mortar, which is definitely the threat in this situation.
Well, if it's a question of Tesla Tower, Mortar, Inferno Tower, the mortar every day of the week is the one that you want to get rid of first, especially if it's in range to damage your own buildings.
And they're straight in with the rocket. It really is no surprise that he has a rocket available to go. And I love the way that he's gone by this deck. Now, Steroidy's been playing this really well. However, how many of those rockets is Nazim going to have on deck to literally, if he's going to play for the one tower, and he's already done that much damage to Steroidy's tower, I mean, who's going to take the first one, you know? It depends. I mean, he's playing for this extremely defensive set of cards. But right now, it's not really working out for him.
But Nazim is actually playing this really clever. He is just, this deck is built to counter the mortar. He has the building to distract it. He has the rocket to do guaranteed building damage. All he's doing is stalling out, defeating the mortar, defeating the Tesla towers. Get rid of the mortar, then bam, his rockets are going to do all the damage he needs. He doesn't need to push, he just needs to destroy the mortar so he can do rocket damage.
That is going to be two Teslas back to back. Now the mortar is probably going to target one of those things. Nice goblin hunt just to go behind the enemy lines. That's going to be good damage. But even better, reservation of that lightning spell ready with those reactions just in case.
A bit of a stalemate going on. Again, the Goblin Hunt's going to take a mortar shot. Going to take one more shot. No, it does destroy itself. I think it'd be a clean shot on the Princess, at least.
I think what's out on the field right now is literally the epitome of what Steroidy's been doing. You have all of these buildings ready to go. And it's just, it's hard to just penetrate that kind of defense. But I mean, the question is, has Nazim got a rocket on deck and is he saving it? But the problem is, it's a lot of elixir and he hasn't got a lot available right now.
But we are down to 10 seconds left. This 900 health tower on the right, Steroidy, is in a little bit of trouble, especially considering he's done so little damage to Nazim's buildings.
Nazim's been saving a lot of elixir, and just so I can say that, going in for a push, the question is, what's going to accompany this giant skeleton?
I mean, there's no way the giant skeleton's going to get through, but he's just soaking up all this damage. The Tesla tower's down, the minion's going to go down. Oh, goblin barrel goes through!
Secret goblin barrel, how much damage? Has he been saving the lightning? Yes, he has! Great reactions there, ready to go. And the princess is just going to sit pretty right there, chipping away at that of those giant buildings there. Take it out once again. The mortar is distracted because once again, Nazim has saved the spawner unit there just to get through the mortar.
Now the minions do manage to get through, but they are quite low. We can see this barbarian hut's going to do a really good job of just distracting all this damage. It's pure distractions. Nothing Steroidy has is getting past this middle point.
That tower's looking pretty delicious for a rocket right now. I mean, let's not be around the bush. If this giant skeleton gets a good push, all he has to do is get through. Golem barrels once again. Has he been saving the lightning? Yes, he has.
Good really defense. Smart play. I mean, again, the barrel's doing damage on impact. It's doing some unavoidable damage, but he's managing to save himself from a lot of goblin damage. But again, this princess again, but the mortar's got through
there
the rocket.
There we go. How much damage is it going to do? Ooh, 100 left. All he needs to do is get one final thing. Nice use of the arrows right there. 11 hit points left. Anything from range will do at this point. Fantastic gameplay.
Now, that was close. Steroidy had a lightning available. That was a question of who manages to get this spell off first to take out that first objective. And Nazim manages to clutch it out once again with that last little
and
bit of damage.
He is sitting there cool as a cucumber. Look at that.
Hey, man, he's ready for this win. He knows he's gone. Okay, my opponent's using mortars. I need a deck going into this tournament that deals with that. And this is that deck. It's the perfect counter.
But there's always the chance that when we had these kind of preliminary group stages where everyone played everyone for an hour and a half, like there's always the chance that when Steroidy turns up, people are like, oh, I don't really expect this guy to have such a strong defensive mortar deck. Going into the semifinals where
or everyone here has the chance to study their opponent. I mean, there is no way that Nazim didn't study up on this guy and went, how can I craft a deck during this downtime that will just completely get around the fact that this guy obviously loves mortars?
But if you main, let's say, I'm not sure what you would call it, but let's say you main the mortar deck. Let's say that really is your
go-to deck.
Your go-to thing is, I play the mortar and I craft my deck around this card. That is going to have a direct counter in what we're seeing from Nazim. But this is now up to Steroidy to make the adjustment, to go, okay, this isn't going to work. It was a close game. He almost got through, but that was more down to Nazim making a slight mistake at the end in dealing with the mortar. Didn't get his building off in time. The mortar did target his tower before he got his building out. But is Steroidy going to change, or is he just going to rely on another mistake?
I guess we just have to wait and see. There's no way to know. And that's the thing about, we are currently using the new spectator mode, which will be available in a free update coming up. So obviously we're using the spectator mode right now, but one of the things is we cannot see the card in the opponent's hand. So it opens up for a lot of speculation.
We can see the cards they've played in this match, and we can see their entire deck once they've played everything in that deck in the match, but we cannot see what's in their hand or cards they haven't played. So you guys and girls at home watching are just as in the mystery as we are.
Now you can see there's some buildings put up almost immediately, and that's one of the benefits of this Tesla Tower, is that it's kind of hard. It only dishes out damage when there is something in its vicinity, right? So it can actually kind of sit there pretty, sitting quite safe. Now, what we saw in the last game was the fact that almost immediately Nazim has gone, yes, obviously stick with his deck, but he's going to stick to this idea of just constantly going for the squad units. Now, Steroidy has been quite reluctant to go for a mortar. He might not necessarily have one. Has gone for the Hog Rider. I do believe this is the first time we've seen him go for this deck.
Now,
this
I think specifically, we may have seen Steroidy completely abandon this mortar deck. I'm not sure how much being it. His old deck was purely crafted for the mortar, we can see. But, I mean, I bet it was just me. We haven't seen a mortar this game yet from him.
That's one of the smart plays that we tend to do. Already going in, the skeleton is distracted. Now that's one of the combinations, and again, saving that lightning spell every single time, remembering that he has a goblin barrel ready to go. So I mean, there's no reason you would change that instant piece of damage. Really smart there from Steroidy just to keep that card in line, ready to go.
But I really like this this adjustment to the Hog Rider, because we've actually seen the Hog Rider make a lot more of an impact in today's tournament than we have seen the mortar. So the Hog Rider definitely a tried and true force to be reckoned with today.
Nazim got a lot of mileage out of that Hog Rider as well, though, in his original set of the quarterfinals, so he's going to be familiar with that card.
Oh no, a bit of a waste on the lightning by Nazim. Tries to finish off the Tesla Tower, but it will die naturally, so a bit of a waste of Elixir, unfortunately.
Hog Rider's going to go straight and try to get out. I'm not sure if that was a freeze. Nice, once again, that's a really good combination, that freeze and the Hog Rider. Going straight, he's going to get some of that poke down. Defense of the Princess is going to get one shot. He's going to get at least one hit right there. Kind of shaving that tower, not doing too much damage,
so now,
but once again,
like I said, we're using this new spectator mode, this observer mode. We have seen Steroidy has played every card in his current deck. No mortar to be seen. He's completely abandoned it.
I like that play. I mean, trying to show that he has other things ready to go. And also the fact that he can change deck when Nazim is locked into a deck that is entirely built to counter mortar.
Oh, the fireball's gonna, wow, it's gonna hit both the hut and the tower for a nice amount of damage. But we can see this spawner tactic from Nazim. He's got a goblin hut and a barbarian hut. Hog Rider goes down, but he's gonna go straight for the, no, it's gonna go straight for the tower. He's gonna cleanly get through. This could be a dead tower on the left if we don't see retaliation.
There's a lot of push going in right now. Going in with the freeze just for good measure.
Oh, wow.
And he gets a very crucial rocket,
the
but I don't think
goblin.
It's enough. Single goblin running straight in there, getting that secret little hit to take out that first tower. Steroidy in a great situation. Has he saved the lightning? That's the question.
Yes,
he had once again. I mean, I would be very surprised if we ever catch him without that lightning ready to go. And just for that situation, not overcommitting, saving the lightning, keeping his elixir ready, and he can just play on that one tower. Looking really good for Steroidy right now. Oh, 80 health left, didn't do enough damage. Hog Rider goes down. That was a good game from Steroidy. That was clutch. I like the adjustment. I really like the adjustment, showing that it's not all about, I mean, yeah, he's got a mortar deck ready to go, but right there you can see he played every single card in his deck.
That lone
and there
goblin,
was
though.
No,
that lone goblin.
He just needed
by
one more, didn't he? He just needed one more troop just to get taken out, but that goblin gonna sneak in there and do a cheeky little backstab on that tower, taking out that last little bit of health.
He was brash, went straight up to him, all right, mate, let's go, you and me building, and the goblin won.
Now the question is, in this situation, I mean, I would be very surprised if we don't see some kind of switch, because Nazim went straight in there and understanding that, you know, Soroti was gonna go for a mortar deck, and then that's kind of the thing about this tournament saying, where we're playing first to three games, where
The option to counterpick the opponent, you know, for those of you that may not understand the whole idea of counterpicking, it's taking the time out to look at what you've lost to. And this actually applies to loads of games. Looking at what you lost to and having the luxury, having lost that next game, to change something up to give yourself a little bit more of an advantage. You know, that's what happens when you lose games, and there's no exception.
That's why game one in a set, while even though you've got potentially, you know, extra games behind you, let's not forget, they are playing first to three. So best of five set, first to three. So winning that first match, even though you've got all those games behind you, gives you the luxury of being able to be the first one to counterpick, should you lose beyond that.
So we can see a very defensive start here from both players. No one's overcommitted to anything. Sometimes we can see potentially early Hog Riders and stuff. But for the most part, these guys will just sit there. Speaking of early Hog Riders, he's going to have to go. And unfortunately, does actually commit to just having the Ice Blizzards on the right-hand side. Double freeze right there.
Oh, wow, they froze each other. Wow, really, really interesting stuff. Hog Rider is going to lose. Now, that was the important thing. The Hog Rider had to die. That was why the freeze was put down. Was because, okay, if this Hog Rider is let loose, my tower is in serious trouble.
Darku's going to run in, completely gets taken out by that minion unit right there. A bit of a mirror match on the left-hand side. Gaining the lightning just to get a little bit of damage on the tower.
Now, nice stuff. One low minion. That really isn't going to do anything. It's going to get shot once by the tower. And
see you later.
Farewell.
Okay, so we have gone back to this kind of defensive situation. Both guys opting to kind of save up some elixir and maybe wait for what the other guy's going to do, or save up for some kind of big push.
Well, let's see what they've already played. We can see both of them have the standard goblins, both of them have the minions, but they have a little bit of differences. We can see the first Tesla tower deployed from Steroidy. Defi seems to favor this building, it seems.
It's definitely an effective building, just kind of sitting there pretty in the front. Hog Rider running in right as the Valkyrie gets spawned, and I like the defense there, waiting for the Inferno unit. Once again, that's the strength of the Inferno Tower, is that it's single damage and extremely high burst. So these slightly high hit points, but single damage, high damage targets will get melted by the Inferno Tower.
I mean, just look at that. It does so much damage. Yes, it does passively lose life over time, but still, just the fact that it's there, it's distracting the big units, and it's doing so much damage to them before it dies itself.
Both players going to lose their buildings at this point. I like the idea. Just poking out there with the poison just to get a little bit of damage there on those barbarians to kind of sort of quell their offense just a little bit.
Takes all the barbarians down to about half, but there's a lot of units going through. The minions are going to be deployed to defense. The lightning is good, does serious damage to the tower, but the barbarians get through the freeze. The barbarians are going through, big damage. Wow, this tower is going down, getting chunked. Lost at least about 4 to 5.
That is a really good amount of poke right there, especially now we have 60 seconds left on the clock. The question is, what's the next play?
Double elixir has been activated, but there's 60 seconds left on the clock, so a lot of scope for aggressive and very fast-paced play.
Speaking of aggressive, we have a Hog Rider paired out with a couple of goblins. Good to go. That's going to do quick damage right there. So that he's going to completely ignore them. The Hog Rider's going to run up behind. This could be it. Good use on the freeze. Double freeze once again. Shades of the beginning of the game.
Rears its head.
Oh, the Hog Rider gets one last hit of 355 health. Now
that
30 seconds left.
One lone hit might be crucial, depending on what comes next.
Hog Rider gets through. Is there any defense left? It's going to go. Oh, wow. Two towers. That Hog Rider isn't going anywhere. But Hog Rider on the left going to go through. They're trying to distract it. Getting one cheeky hit again. One more hit from Hog Rider is all it's going to take.
Goblins are going to run through. That's not going to do any damage.
That's dangerous.
Point.
Steroidy has access to lightning. We don't know if it's in his hand, but 99 health. He just needs to chip that away.
Nice positioning there, the barbarians. Now here comes the Valkyrie.
Here comes the fireball. Great play right there. Steroidy's going to take that tower. And once again,
move on into the next game after once again stealing that final tower right before the time finish.
Also, very, very impressive play. Steroidy showing he doesn't need the mortar to win. That it isn't a crutch. It's his favorite, sure, but he doesn't need it. He has counters ready if you are ready to defeat it.
Now here's the situation. I mean, if you win one more game when you're two games up, that's the difference between 1,000 euros and 10,000. I mean, if you win this, you go into the grand finals to play where you get at least 3,000 euros. But if you win, you take home everything. It's a very top-heavy payout. Let's not forget that.
I mean, these guys, they're playing really cool right now. I know there was a lot of nerves at the start of the day. They do seem to have cleared up somewhat. I guess the players are just getting a bit more comfortable, but they were playing for 1,000 euros before. The winner of this goes home with 3,000. So a 2,000 euro difference between losing this and winning it. Second to first is 7,000. I want to see how they play when there is 7,000 euros separating them. All the cappers of the Twitch chat.
Shout out to the Twitch chat. Love to see it. Now, the thing is, in this situation, I mean, I've said this earlier on, but a lot of these guys, this is kind of their first tournament situation. So they're playing for so much money, and the pressure really is on at this point. When you get put in a situation where one game could potentially send you home and cost you a lot of money, what do you do? Do you keep it cool? Do you manage to, you know, do you accidentally choke it out? Who knows? But right now, both these players, I think, are being very calm and collective. They do seem a lot more comfortable now than they did at the start of the tournament series.
I'm just happy to see this. I mean, 200 came together today. Lots of new faces, lots of unfamiliar faces, but what united all of them was just a love for the game and just finding it genuinely a fun experience. But now they're playing for big cash, and they've managed to get themselves down to top four out of 200 of some of the best players in the world.
Now, is Nazim going to be able to pull this one through and tighten that knot, bringing it one game apiece away from winning? Or is Steroidy going to take this 3-1 and move into Grand Finals? We'll have to wait and see. Going in for the Hog Rider once again. I mean, it's a very powerful unit, one of the most, if not the most popular unit of this tournament so far.
There you see the minion horde go down. Icewind's going to try and take him out, but is going to get destroyed. I don't see these minions doing much. The Valkyrie is good.
I mean, let's not forget the strength of the Valkyrie. I mean, it's not necessarily against the minion group because they are airborne, but her ability to attack in a circle around her, taking up multiple units. Here comes the Lone Hog Rider. Once again, good patience on the Inferno Tower to just distract that unit. Take him out easily.
Now, that really is the make or break we're seeing. If you've got a building ready to distract the Hog Rider, you're okay. But if you get caught without it, that's when you start taking some serious damage.
We've seen people get caught without it before, and it's done a big chunk of damage. And in many cases, they have been quite deciding factors. That Hog Rider push with the troops behind that will just dish out the damage and act as good distractions. I mean, it just hasn't stopped really, has it?
Nazim setting up a push again with the Ice Wizard, but we see the goblins to the left. Not quite sure how much damage they'll do by themselves. Maybe just a distraction. Not quite sure what that was about.
Sometimes it might be a way to potentially bait out arrows to see maybe Nazim has some arrows good to go. Maybe it's just clearing the unit and just making some space. But going in the Ice Wizard, is he going to get one hit? Is going to get one lone hit. But unfortunately, going to get erased very quickly with that minion army.
But
and
manages to chip down a little further. He's doing a little bit of damage infrequently to the tower, but slowly but surely it is going to add up. And especially when it's coming from a Hog Rider, or then goes big, we've got a Hog Rider and Barbarians going
left. That's a chunky offense right there. They're going to go and try and take out those minions. Nice freeze just to pause those units right there. Very crucial, the fact that he had a Hog Rider and some chunky Barbarians running along with him. Great use of the freeze just to stop that offense dead in its tracks.
That was really good. Minions are going to go down. The Valkyrie manages to take out the tower, but again, Steroid is going to keep himself in this game, going to take them out before they do any tower damage, and we see a Tesla tower go down again.
This is where things are going to get crucial. Double Elixir, 60 seconds left before we go into sudden death, and it's going to decide one tower could send either of these guys into a bad situation.
Oh, Hog Rider goes in close to us, straight past the Barbarians. The poison's good.
I like the idea of accompanying him with the poison, going in with the freeze as well. Good defense. That's going to do a good chunk of damage right there, and it's going to even things out quite nicely on both towers. Now, Nazim is sitting in a good situation.
Good Inferno Tower to distract the Hog Rider, otherwise that push would have been for nothing. Going to slowly but surely take away some damage from both of them. Left Tower sitting at 1,300 for Nazim is doing a good job of just chipping this down. Inferno Tower is still there, so he's going to save himself from a push for at least a little while.
Steroidy's definitely on the back foot right now. He has a lot more work to do, but once again, one good push, one crucial little mistake could decide everything. Battle ends in 10 seconds. We probably are definitely going to go into overtime. Nice use of the poison just to quell those offensive units. That's going to do good damage to basically all of them. Varrica's going to run in there and do some good circle damage around as well.
Now, I feel like the poison was a great choice, because look at the amount of damage that did. He managed to get max poison damage on multiple targets.
Here comes the Hog Rider running in, but the Test Tower's going
to
use up.
Oh, nice freeze!
Once again, that tried and tested combination of the freeze and the Hog Rider, but both players using their freeze. So once again, we're going to find ourselves at a stalemate.
So freezing on reaction to your opponent's freeze truly is a way to go, no, this freeze isn't going to work. My freeze won't do much, but at least it's going to stop you from getting anything off it. It's just a complete definition of a stalemate.
Good use, the Inferno Tower. Once again, that's going to do good damage. Once again, these guys are doing very similar plays to one another. I mean, that pairing of the Goblins with the Hog Rider, I mean, it does so much work.
Question is the Hog Rider going to take out this tower before he dies? He's going to run straight through. He is going to go down. He's going to save himself some damage, but we see this wizard doing AoE damage. This Ice Mage doing huge damage to these Barbarians. I don't think they're going to get to him before he manages to kill them, especially with the Valkyrie behind him.
I really want to know what this final unit is that Steroidy has good to go. We're yet to see it, but Nazim has played every single ounce of his cards, and as you can see, hasn't got a fireball, hasn't got a rocket. He has to push.
I was about to say, he hasn't used this final card. It's either a rocket or a fireball. So big damage manages.
He's gonna try and stall. I like the idea. Stalling with the lightning to potentially build that final piece of elixir to get that freeze on deck. He's still gonna get some poke and is still in a bad situation. But I think that freeze was everything.
Now that was good damage. Considering Nazim is still sitting pretty at max health on his towers, he is in no danger here. But if Steroidy can at least manage to last a minute and 40 seconds, even if he manages to get some tower down or keep his towers alive, he might manage to make this game a draw.
Here comes the Tesla Tower. That is, once again, going to act as a good distraction. He just has to stall for a minute and a half.
Good use of the Barbarians as well, but the Valkyrie is going to take out a good amount of damage because, again, she attacks in an area around her.
Now, I feel like that may have been a preemptive freeze from Nazeem because he now doesn't have it. And a Hog Rider's in.
There's no already. Freeze and a Hog Rider charging on the left-hand side. Wrecking Crew coming in on the left-hand side, trying to do as much tower damage as possible. Good defense on the poison. That's going to do big damage to every unit going in.
Okay, so the poison was used defensively that time. Nazeem manages to keep his tower alive. 1,700 health, still a 1,000 health lead on Steroidi's left tower. But if Steroidi can hold out for 60 more seconds, he might be able to make this game a draw and keep things the way they are.
Nazeem just needs one good push. I mean, a couple of decent strikes from the Hog unit, and that 710 damage tower. Oh, we'll get the sentence out eventually. It is going to go straight out of there.
Now, Hog Rider's going to be dead. There's the freeze to stop it from taking too much damage, but the tower itself, the Tesla tower, going to take things out. The poison, good. Going to do some chip damage on all these units. The goblins go down. Tesla tower might go down to it. Tower's taking a lot of damage too. Barbarian's taken, but there's the Hog Rider, but the Inferno tower again. So ready. But he is going to go in, freezing the Inferno tower, reserving a good amount of health. But once again, I do think the Hog Rider is going to get taken out before he goes in. And again, we have the AoE damage of the Ice Mage. Counterattack.
Hog Rider goes left. The freeze has been used, but there's a Tesla tower again to distract the Hog Rider. The goblins, that freeze is good. Going to take out the Tesla tower. If he can get this tower and get one more hit on this tower,
he has a charge
straight through. Who knows? He isn't going to get a crucial hit. This is going to go down to 5 seconds. In this situation, I don't know. I don't think it's going to be good because the thing is, Nazeem does not have any specific ranged damage that he can just put on a tower. In that situation, if he had a fireball, if he had a rocket, especially if he had a rocket in that situation, I mean, that's what Steroidi was doing in those preliminary games, right? Saving his rocket for the final moment.
Now, and they didn't have anything. The true heartbreaking moment at the end of that game was if Nazeem's Hog Rider got one hit on that left tower, the poison would have been enough to finish it off. That was so close. But Steroidi manages to play from the back foot literally all game and managed to draw it out to a draw. And now they're back at square one.
It was an interesting style of play. It's no mystery right now that Steroidi has a very defensive style. I mean, some people will opt to build for giant pushes, some people will opt to build for tower defense. Now, the fact that what these guys did, they actually had a very, very similar metagame to each other where it was all about the Hog Rider.
However, they both almost looked like set one of the top eight.
For sure, absolutely. Because the thing is, in that situation, they both had some kind of decent health building that could just save it. You know, they'd literally just save it when the Hog Rider comes in. But the fact that they both had freeze means that they can both use the same kind of attack. But at the same time, if you know you have to use your freeze, the second one player uses their freeze for an attack, the other player literally just used the freeze in the exact same situation and just put it down at a neutral state once again. So what we saw there was, I think Nazeem was playing better for chipping out the tower, but because they had such a similar style of play, it wasn't enough to clutch out one of the wins.
But what I like about this deck, and this is purely observation, so correct me if I'm wrong, but both of them have the Hog Rider, which is really the core of their pushes, but then at the same time, they both have counters to the Hog Rider built into their deck to get ready for what they try and do.
Well, one had Tesla Tower, one had Inferno Tower, right? I mean, it's the same kind of fundamental play, but it's just a slightly different unit.
Looks like they're taking their time going into this next game. I mean, with so much money separating them, I can't really blame them. Looks like we are going to go straight into what is this game five?
At this point, I mean, we did have a draw. So, I mean, at this situation, Nazeem is still two games down and Steroidi still needs to just win one game. So he has opted to go straight back in. Now, was that a bluff? Was that I don't like the fact that you've got a spawner because I've gone back to a mortar deck? It's just like that. Of course he has. Okay, so giving away that he's a little bit unhappy. Straight in with a rocket as well. These guys waste no time on getting that damage. So the fact that Nazeem already has a spawner and Nazeem already has a rocket, Steroidi has already played his mortar as well. So these guys have gone into this knowing exactly what the fundamental play is.
Now, if you guys and girls at home have just joined us, Steroidi did use this deck against Nazeem in the first match of this set, but unfortunately it didn't go his way. Nazeem was ready. The core of Steroidi's deck really is that mortar, that big range damage, and Nazeem knew Steroidi was going to use that, so his deck is built to counter that. They just faked each other out. They had the opportunity to change decks.
This was definitely a matter of prediction. Yes. You know, predicting, not even like within the game itself, it was predicting what deck the opponent is going to choose in this first to three setting.
Looks like Nazeem did manage to get the read. He did predict that Steroidi was going to go back to this mortar deck, so he did get his counter ready. Goblin's going to get a little bit of damage, some big damage adding up to that left tower. Let's not forget the rocket itself and the arrows and the goblin barrel. So much guaranteed range damage.
This may necessarily be a repeat of the first game we saw, where what was going on was Nazeem had a deck that was built around countering the mortar and just out-sustaining. That's what the rocket is for. It's so that he can sit defensive and nullify the mortar with a single unit, but constantly poke away at least one tower with the rocket. And as I can say,
the Rockets. Droidy also going in with a rocket of his own. Both players now are going to have to be very careful with how defensively they play.
Not going to do as much damage to Nazim's tower as Droidy is currently suffering. See, the skeletons are good, but then again, skeletons not going to do too much damage. They do die in basically one hit from the tower, so they're not as good by themselves. Mainly just a deterrent, I think, to stop units from attacking and getting close.
This is that make or break situation again. 60 seconds left, doing good damage, just chipping away. A couple more of those, Nazim is going to be in a good situation. And once again, there's so many single units. And talking about big damage, going straight in with the giant skeleton. What is the follow-up? There is a princess behind who's going to churn out damage and damage that mortar from a distance. Once again, going straight in with another goblin hut going in. Has he got the arrows ready to go?
Managed to at least take out the princess, but we see it. Steroidy actually doesn't have access to the lightning, which was his sort of go-to counter for the goblin barrel. He doesn't have that, so the goblins are going to do a lot more damage in the barrel than they did in the first match.
Especially if he accidentally mistimes that arrow, takes a little bit less time. Speaking of lightning, Nazim has got lightning good to go.
I really don't see Steroidy managing to come back from this. The lightning was core to countering that goblin barrel. Right now, so much guaranteed damage. I don't think Steroidy's going to really be able to get some serious damage on this tower in the 10 seconds to go. Right, this
point, oh, there's the rocket! How much damage? He's gonna get going straight here. 401 straight into that. 3 seconds left. That rocket, unfortunately, it's not gonna do much at all. Nazim brings it back. This is our first situation of this tournament where it's come down to the final game.
Now, we mentioned in this set counterpicking. Nazim is in a strange situation now. He managed to make the read. He changed his deck after the draw because he predicted that Steroidy was gonna go back to this mortar deck. He is now locked in. I guess unless they draw.